Our speaker tonight is Todd Surovell from the University of Wyoming, he is the current director of the Frizen Institute. And Todd was graced us here on this very stage 3 or 4 years ago and gave one of our best Archaeology Café presentations ever. So we are looking forward to a great, great talk tonight.
Thank you, Doug. Well, thank you for y'all. Thank you for coming tonight. And I'm going to thank Kate for inviting me. And it's wonderful to be back in Tucson. I will take any excuse to be back in Tucson from Wyoming, especially in January. Tonight, I want to talk about a question that has vexed me in the field of archaeology for a long time, more than 100 years, when people first arrived in the New World. Kate won't let me use PowerPoint, which is my usual crutch when public speaking, so I'm going to ask for some audience participation. I want to do a little exercise with the audience. I don't know how well it's going to work. I'm taking a calculated risk here. The point of this is I want you to start thinking about this problem when people first came to the New World in a new way, in a different way, and hopefully this will help us, this will nicely frame how I'm thinking about this problem. So I'm going to pass around this bag. It's got little pieces of paper in it. Everybody take out one piece of paper. You don't have to participate, the more people that do, the better, and you probably won't have to say anything. Only very few of you will. So I want to begin with sort of a short biography of my personal experience with this question and how it came to me. And then I want to sort of give you the state of the art of archaeological knowledge about this question. Then we'll go through this exercise and look at a new way to think about the problem and tell you sort of my current thinking about this question of when people first arrived on this continent. And I should specify that when I'm talking about North America, I'm talking about the lower 48. I'm not including Alaska. I'm talking about the lower 48, the unglaciated part of North America at the end of the last ice age. So 20 years ago, just over 20 years ago, in the fall of 1994, I was a senior at the University of Wisconsin completing my bachelor's degree in anthropology, and I took a class from James Stoltman. By the way, where are my markers? Here they are. We were required to take a senior seminar, and this was a seminar that was focused on one specific topic. And the topic happened to be the colonization of the New World, and when did people first arrive in the New World? That was simply by chance that was the topic. I didn't have a choice what the class was going to be. And that accident, that it happened to be about that topic, really shaped my career. I have a vivid memory of the first day of class when Dr. Stoltman went to the chalkboard, and on the chalkboard he wrote this. He said, 11,200 BP. That's the number. Everything we talked about in this entire class revolved around this number. 1994, this was the age of the Clovis complex, the start of the Clovis complex being the first clear indications of humans in the New World, marked by fluted points, large bifacially fluted points, often found in association with extinct megafauna, like mammoth, mastodon, bison. You know it well. It's very well manifested in southeast Arizona. We certainly talked about this question of when. We also talked about the question of Pleistocene extinctions, what caused the extinctions of large animals at that time, and all kinds of questions surrounding human colonization of the New World. And it strikes me as interesting that in archaeology, we can have an entire class that centers on one number. If you think about this question, when did people arrive in the New World? Fundamentally, it's not a very interesting question. Now, I just told you I'm going to talk to you about this question for about 40 minutes, so I apologize for talking about an uninteresting question for 40 minutes. But it's a historical question. I can think of many more interesting questions to ask of the first people in the New World. What would it be like to be the first person to walk into the United States, a continent or a country that had never been inhabited by humans before? What would your subsistence be like and your social organization? What would your technology be like? How would your language be affected? And yet this question of when people arrived, and this was our best answer in 1994, has been received a huge amount of attention in archaeology, right? We've spent millions and millions of dollars trying to answer this question, published thousands of papers. We've had very, very vociferous debates about this. We find new sites, we argue about them endlessly, we yell about each other literally at conferences about when people first arrived. So while it's historically, as a historical question, I don't find it particularly interesting, yet it's something I've obsessed over for 20 years. If you think about it, if we could finally answer this question, people came to the New World in 16,242 BP. The end. It's kind of a dead end, right? Where do we go from there? Well, actually, it was on June 12th, on a Wednesday at 2:12 in the afternoon, right? I mean, it's kind of a dead end question. But still, we make a huge, huge deal about it. Now, since 1994, this number has changed. If I was going to teach that class today and mimic Jim Stoltman, I would probably write this. ...11,400 BP. The end, thank you. Those are radiocarbon dates, right? Radiocarbon dates are not the same thing as calendar years or calendar ages. When we date an archaeological site and it produces a radiocarbon date of 11,400 BP, that actually corresponds to a calendar age of approximately 13,400 BP. Where I get this number, and this number, 13,400 BP, this is the dating of the El Fin del Mundo site dug by Vance Holliday, which is a Clovis site in Sonora, Mexico. You probably have heard about this. This is a gomphotheric kill site in northern Mexico. That would be sort of the current state of knowledge about Clovis, right? Now, of course, we argue about, is there anything before Clovis? So how I came into this field, this class at the University of Wisconsin 20 years ago was hugely inspirational to me. It was the first time that I actually delved into the primary literature as an undergraduate, and we looked at this problem very closely. Not only that, at the time there were a number of sites that were being debated and discussed by the archaeological community that suggested that the antiquity of humans in the New World was actually considerably deeper than this. In the middle 1990s, sites that were at the forefront of North American archaeology were Meadowcroft Rock Shelter in western Pennsylvania, which it has never been published in great detail, but is argued to have human occupation considerably before this, 14,000, 15,000, and maybe even as deep as 20,000 BP. Also at that time, there was a site in Brazil called Pedra Furada, which is a rock shelter, which was argued to have human occupation going back 40,000 years ago. But at that time, there was no site that loomed larger in this debate than the site of Monteverde in southern Chile, excavated by Tom Dillehay. And Dr. Dillehay came to our class and talked to us, small group, small seminar, about 15 students, talked to us specifically about his work at Monteverde. At Monteverde, you have incredible organic preservation. You have wooden, what are argued to be wooden implements, digging sticks, wooden houses, chewed leaves, pieces of hide and flesh preserved. Really unusual archaeological record because of the organic preservation, but what was most unusual about it was the age. It produced a radiocarbon age around 12,500 BP, or a calendar age of about let me check my notes here. Monte Verde in southern Chile dates to around 14,800 calendar years BP, or around 15,000 years ago. Now, this is old, for sure. This is vastly older than any Clovis site, even Clovis sites that we know of today. It's 2,400 years older than the El Fin del Mundo site. And not only that, its location was unexpected and surprising, right? For decades, we had argued, and we still do, that humans entered the New World across the Bering Land Bridge from Northeast Asia into Northwest Alaska. There, they were essentially walled in by two large ice sheets, the Laurentide Ice Sheet in the east and the Cordilleran Ice Sheet in the west. And then they moved into the Great Plains. They came down through the ice-free corridor, and they came into the Great Plains somewhere around Edmonton, Alberta, and spread through the New World from there. So the oldest sites you'd expect to find in Alaska, and then in the northern part of the United States, the lower 48. And the youngest sites of the oldest sites should be in southern South America. But here was the oldest site in the New World, way down 13,000 kilometers south of the ice-free corridor. It made no sense. And if you allow some time for people to get there, let's say it took 1,000 years to get from the ice-free corridor to Monte Verde by the process of colonization, it means that humans had to be in North America almost 16,000 years before. So we had, at the time, roughly 3,000 years of missing prehistory in North America. As an undergraduate who was applying to graduate school and looking for something to study in archaeology, this was incredibly exciting to me. This turned North American archaeology on its head. It seemed like we had a lot to learn. This is a big chunk of time that we knew nothing about. So I came to Tucson in 1995, 20 years ago. Another accident, I should note, thinking about accidents that happen in your career that sort of guide your life, another accident, I came here to work with Vance Haynes, of course, who spent his life focused on this very question, has done a lot of incredible research. And I came here to work with Vance, and I did work with Vance. Another wonderful accident I had was getting to work with Mary Steiner and Steve Kuhn, who are sitting in the front here. And it also made a huge influence on my career in a positive way. And I'm very grateful for that. And I think my perspective on this question is kind of a blend of all the perspectives I got at the University of Arizona over my time here. Vance Haynes, of course, is famous for being an expert in the study of the first Americans. He's also famous for being incredibly conservative in his point of view. This debate over these dates has often been framed as a debate between the Clovis first camp, those people who think the Clovis complex represents the first incursion of humans into North America, and the pre-Clovis camp, who see humans in the New World before Clovis, say several hundred years before Clovis, several thousand years before Clovis, several tens of thousand years before Clovis. Vance is very much on the Clovis first side of things, or he has been for most of his career. And this was the context in which I was trained. Also here in Tucson, you had Paul Martin, the champion of the overkill hypothesis. Vance and Paul, I should note, don't agree about that, but Paul was also very conservative in his belief about when the New World was colonized. He was very strongly believed that Clovis was first. In 1973, in March of 1973, which is an important month and year for me, that was the year of my birth and month of my birth. It was also the month and year that Paul Martin published The Discovery of America in Science magazine. I think that paper and I are forever tied because of that. It has some kind of strange astrological connection. In that paper, Paul lays out this very specific model of New World colonization, where humans entered North America around this time, 11,200 radiocarbon years BP, or say 13,200 calendar years BP. their populations explode as they hunt these large extinct megafauna to extinction, and they colonize all of North and South America in about 1,000 years. And that's sort of the status quo for the Clovis first model. We might have refined it a little bit. We might have pushed Clovis back in time a little bit since then. But this is the target for anybody who believes people were in the New World before Clovis, is Paul's model. It's had an incredibly long life, this model, and it continues to persist, although maybe not in its strictest form, because it seems to have some explanatory power. So this was the context in which I was trained, this very conservative context in which New World colonization is relatively young. It happens at the end of the last ice age, around 13,000 years ago. Since that time, of course, there have been new discoveries and new sites proposed to predate this. And I'm going to give you a list of them and discuss them very briefly. But ultimately, I want to argue that if we really want to answer this question, we can't do it simply by digging more sites. Logically, I'm going to argue, we have to use some other method. This microphone takes some getting used to. But this method that we've been using for over 100 years now to try to determine when people came to North America, digging sites, evaluating them carefully, we have to supplement it with something. But let me talk to you a little bit about some of the new evidence that we have. So El Fin del Mundo, this Clovis Gompathir kill, dates to about 13,400 BP. It's Clovis. But now we have some sites earlier than that. We have the Manus mastodon site. This is in the Olympic Peninsula of Washington State. It was actually dug in the 1970s. It was recently redated. It's around 13,800 BP. It's a mastodon. It has what appears to be a bone projectile point stuck into one of its ribs. It's very well dated. It's hard to argue that doesn't indicate a human presence. There's Paisley Caves, which is a rock shelter in Oregon that has a deeply stratified sequence. Down in the bottom of it, they have coprolites, fossilized human feces. Those have been dated to 14,200 BP. Argued to be human coprolites on the basis of DNA, human DNA recovered from those coprolites, and directly dated. Schaefer and Hebbior sites. These are, if I remember correctly, woolly mammoths, definitely proboscideans up in the Great Lakes in Wisconsin associated with artifacts. They date to 14,500 and 14,800 BP, roughly contemporaneous with Monteverde component 2. There's actually two components at Monteverde. We rarely talk about the first. The Deborah Friedkin site, let's call it Deborah F, in Texas. This is a deeply stratified site in the Edwards Plateau. Many cultural components down to Clovis and then stuff beneath Clovis. Argued to be up to 15,500 years old. The Cactus Hill site in Virginia. Cactus Hill is very interesting. It's in a sand dune. It has a Clovis component. It has artifacts beneath that Clovis component. Are we passing that bag around, by the way? It has artifacts beneath that Clovis component, buried in dune sands. Those sands have dated to 18,000 BP. On the East Coast, in the Delmarva Peninsula, in the Chesapeake Bay, Darren Lowry and Dennis Stanford have recovered artifacts from eroding cut banks on the Chesapeake Bay. Call that Delmarva. There's a series of localities. Those cut banks have buried soils. They're fairly well dated. They argue that these archaeological components date between 18 and 25,000 years ago, and maybe older. Monteverde. Monteverde II is the second component of Monteverde that I mentioned to you. In Monteverde, there's a deeper component with chipstone, radiocarbon dated to 33,000 years ago. The Topper site in South Carolina has a Clovis component, and beneath it in sands, it has artifacts argued to be in excess of 40,000 years old. Okay? Now, how do we go about evaluating this evidence? Well, forever we have been doing it the same way. In the early 20th century, a physical anthropologist named Alistair Lischka developed three criteria for evaluating any site that we think dates to the Pleistocene in North America, and we could apply these criteria really to any site to check its age. And these criteria can be applied to any comparable problem if we want to look at the colonization of Australia, or the hominid colonization of Eurasia, or the colonization of New Zealand, we could apply the same criteria. And according to Alistair Lischka, in order to demonstrate that humans are really in the New World 40,000 years ago, or 18,000 years ago, or 14,200 years ago, we only have to demonstrate three things. One, that we definitely have artifacts, or human remains, something definitely made by humans. There are cases of sites like Pedra Furada in Brazil where it was argued that the things called artifacts are actually made by natural processes, for example. So we have to have artifacts or human remains, or I suppose a human coprolite would count. They have to be in undisturbed stratigraphic context. They have to be buried, and that stratigraphy has to be undisturbed. In other words, we don't have mixing of things up and down that could cause, for example, young artifacts to be associated with old sediments. And third, they have to be associated with good dates. We have to have some means of dating these sites reliably. Could the Topper site simply appear to be 40,000 BP because there's something wrong with our dates? Could the Cactus Hill site simply appear to be 18,000 years old because there's something wrong with our dates? And I could certainly go through all of these sites, and if you have questions about them, I'd be happy to answer those questions and tell you what I think about each of them. But what I want to do instead is take this process to its logical conclusion. This is how we determine the age of New World colonization. We slowly push back the date by finding older and older and older sites, right? What if we dug every site? What if there were no sites left to dig anymore? We dug up every piece of ground in the United States. We had a complete understanding of the archaeological record, and there was nothing left to find. Would we know when people arrived in the New World? I see one person shaking their head no. I would say the answer to that question is no, we wouldn't. Why? Because maybe people were here before, but those sites have since been lost to erosion. Or maybe they were dug up in a backhoe when somebody was digging out a basement. So if we take this process to its logical conclusion, we still don't know the answer to this question, is my answer. Which says to me that in addition to digging up sites and finding more sites, we have to do something else. We have to view this problem in some other way. And that's what the point of this exercise is. It might be a miserable failure. I don't know what you pulled out of that bag, so we'll see how it goes. But we're going to go around the room, and I'm going to ask you what you found. That bag. Where's the bag? This is the archaeological record. of a newly discovered continent, and you guys have just been excavating it for me. And what I want to do is see if we can figure out when this continent was colonized. I know when it was colonized. That's a nice thing about this archaeological record. Compared to the United States, I know when this one was colonized. So let's see what we're going to find. What I want to do here is essentially simulate the history of archaeological research. As we dig more and more sites, each of you should have dug four sites, if you pulled out one piece of paper. I may have made a mistake cutting the paper occasionally, so some of you may have excavated three or five. But we're going to look at how the evolution of the oldest known site, how it evolves as our sample gets larger and larger. And as we do this, I'm going to have to keep track of what happens. So I'm going to count all of you as we go around the room. We're going to start with Mary. What's the oldest site that you found, Mary? 3191. So we've excavated four sites, and the oldest site that we found is 3,191 years old. Okay, anything older? Let's go around the table.
I can read it, 16192.
Okay. We've pushed back the colonization date to 16,192.
Seventeen oh seven eight.
Congratulations, you just found the oldest site on this continent. You just got a paper in science. Steve, anything older than that? Anything older than that? Nope. The oldest site you found. The biggest number.
Twenty-six one oh nine.
Now you're a super famous archaeologist now. Way to go. 27034. All right, we're pushing back the colonization date slowly. Next table. What did you get? 30,000. This is happening very quickly. And all you archaeologists who used to be famous, everybody forgot about you. Anything older? Nope. Anything older? All right, we have four more, nothing older than that. Anything older, Ed? Nope. Coming back this way? Anything older? Nope, 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 nope. All right, over here, Melissa? Nope. Mary?
We're super famous. 31007.
Oh. Mary's on PBS right now. Way to go, Mary. Older, 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 older. Nope. Nope, nope, nope. Eight more. Okay, hold on. Let me catch up. I'm not doing very good record keeping here. Okay, where are we? Back of the room. Anything older? Four more. Anybody at this table, anything older? Nope, sorry, you're not famous. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, eight. Nope.
You've given me numbers to put on your artifact, Todd.
But nothing older, right, Sherry?
Oh, I've got little ones, like 2,983.
Well, welcome to the world of most of us. I'm in the same world as you. I don't have a super old site either. You guys? Nope. Anything older? Nope. Older? Older? Older. All right. Well, now we've dug, by my estimation, let's see, 320 archaeological sites. And the oldest one we found is 31,077 BP. Mary Pras Yunus is incredibly famous, I think. Isn't that correct? Didn't you have the oldest one? Mary, you win the prize for being famous, a new pair of aviator sunglasses. Put those on and enjoy your fame and glory. This is how we push back the date of colonization, right? We dig sites, and the oldest site we know of is when people came. Let's look at how this evolved. I see the world through graphs. I can't help it. I'm a very visually oriented person. Let's make a graph. This is the sample size. This is how many sites we've dug. Sample size. And this is the oldest site we found. Let's go from 1, or from 0 to 320. So the first oldest site we found was 3,000 years old, and the last one was 31,000. So let's go from 0 to 40,000 BP here. So we dug 4 sites and we pushed it back to about 3,000. Let me finish making my graph. This is 10,000. This is 20,000, this is 30,000. So we dug 4 sites, we pushed it back to 3,000. This is 200, this is 100. Okay, then we dug 4 more sites, and we very quickly pushed it back to about 16,000. And then we very quickly pushed it back to another, to about 17,000. And then we pushed it back to about 19,000. And then it took a while. Let's see, we got around 20 sites and we pushed it back to 26,000, say up here. The 29 sites, we pushed it back to around 30,000. And then we topped out at 31,000 very quickly. We didn't even get to that side of the room after about 32 sites. If we connect those dots, it looks something like this. And then we didn't find anything older. It flattened out. And then the archaeological record was destroyed. Thanks, Doug.
Not a problem. Curiosity, Dana White.
You can make it work. Looking at this, I'm just curious what you guys think the oldest number in the bag is. Now notice, this is increasing, but the rate of increase is slowing. It's getting really, really flat. If we had another 500 people in this room, do you think we would have pushed it back a little further? Probably, right? What do you think the biggest number in the bag was? 35,000? 35, 60, 40, 33, I heard. 100,000. Okay, anybody else? Well, this is slowly increasing, right? And it's increasing. What's going to limit how far it can go up is what is going to limit the maximum value this can reach is the oldest site on this continent, right? We can't get beyond that, right? And got all the way out to here. We collected 320 sites, and we didn't get anything older than 31,000. So it's going to increase relatively slowly, and it's going to approach this theoretical limit. This theoretical limit is the oldest site that there is to find. And most of you think that's relatively young. 3 out of 5 of you think it's, say, less than 40,000. A couple of you are a little more optimistic. Of course, there could be the number 1 billion in here, or 1 million. You don't know. But in theory, we could use this, one way we could approach this problem is to use this trend to try to estimate where that curve is going, right? It would be strange if we found out here 100,000 and it instantly jumped. Now let's think about the history of New World archaeology and how that's played out. Notice, with fairly small samples, we got fairly far back in time. This doesn't really mimic the colonization of North America, right? We don't easily find sites older than 20,000 in North America. This isn't a very good representation of North America. But how did the history of American archaeology work out? I'll do this carefully. But remember this shape, right? The history of American archaeology. What was the site that broke us through the Pleistocene in North American archaeology? The Folsom site, right. What year was that found? 1928. 1926 was the Folsom discovery. So we'll say 1900. This is the oldest site known. The discovery of a fluted Folsom point between the ribs of a bison antiquus in northeastern New Mexico at the Folsom site. The site was found by a black cowboy named George McJunkin in 1906. Just after 1900, here we are today. Before George McJunkin found that in 1906, say here, the oldest site we knew, we'll make this 20,000 here. Oldest site we knew, I'm not sure. Let's call it 6,000 at 1900, somewhere in here. And then when George McJunkin found that very early in the history of archaeology, this is before we had excavated many sites, probably less than 300, we instantly pushed it back to about 12,500 BP. Then at the Clovis site, the Blackwater Draw site, again in eastern New Mexico, beneath Folsom artifacts, we found Clovis points associated with mammoth around 13,000 years ago. We pushed it back like this. Okay, so that's 1933. And today, where are we? Well, let's look at this curve. Looks very similar, right? Since 1933, we've been trying to push this back and back and back with very little luck. So little luck that some people still believe Clovis is actually first. Now, we can sort of choose our own adventure and say Topper site, put it up here. Fin del Mundo, put it here. Manus site, put it here. But it looks pretty much the same as our little exercise, right? Very early on, we were able to get very, very close to the, well, in this case, I can tell you the colonization date, because I invented this continent. The colonization date, in the case of that bag, was 32,124 BP. With a very small number of sites, we were able to get relatively close to that. We only dug 320 sites, and we got almost within 1,000 years of that, right? The oldest site in the bag, incidentally, was 31,441. So Mary got very close to the oldest known site on my made-up Ziploc continent. There's really three lessons to be learned from this exercise. One, this is kind of what we expect. And if you look at the history of archaeology for any of these colonization events, it looks very similarly. Very quickly, we push back the date. This would certainly characterize Australia well. And then we slowly and incrementally push it back, and it's coming towards some unknown colonization date. It's what we would call asymptotically approaching that. This is called an asymptote or a limit. And this curve is slowly approaching that limit. the actual date of colonization. We're trying to figure out what that is. And it, and our exercise, again, very nicely mimicked the history of New World archaeology. If we look at our exercise and we look at how it proceeded, we can say very clearly, this is not a good model of New World colonization, right? And a lot of you had sites older than 20,000 BP in a fairly small sample. This is not a very good model of New World colonization. So how can we get beyond this Alice Erdlischka evaluating site by site evidence to come to some answer that doesn't require us to find a site out there that may not exist? Well, we can look at this problem theoretically. We can model it. I could create as many of these bags as I want. I could create thousands of these bags. I would need to give thousands of talks in Tucson. I would need thousands of audiences. And we can see which bags realistically reproduce certain aspects of American archaeology and which ones don't. This one doesn't. In this model, the way I created these numbers, and Sherry's right, most of the numbers in the bag are very small. In fact, the most common sites are the most recent ones. What I did with that bag was I assumed a colonization date again at 32,124 BP. I had a population of 50 people come into the continent. They grew to a population of 1 million at a rate, a maximum population growth rate of 1% per year. Then I removed some sites. I assumed that more people produce more archaeological sites, so I can create an archaeological record on the basis of that assumption. And then I correct for preservation bias. We can model this very precisely. We know that sites that have been around for a long time have a much greater chance of being removed from the archaeological record than sites that are young. And then we can see the archaeological record that's left, and then we can simulate archaeological research and see what we produce. And we can ask which scenarios realistically produce the archaeological record that we observe in North America today. So we can simply look at the problem theoretically. We can model this, and I don't need 1,000 Tucson audiences, of course, because we can do this in the computer. I can create 1 million bags in the computer very quickly, and I can then sample them. I can say, if we have a sample of, say, 25,000 sites in the New World, imagine if we had 25,000 sites, how close we would have been to this, right? We would have just about emptied this bag and we would have had a lot more confidence about the number. And in fact, you guys, 3 out of 5 of you, were capable of predicting pretty well what that colonization date was just by looking at this trend. So why can't we do that with a sample of 25,000 sites in North America? Shouldn't we be able to estimate the biggest number in the bag? It's a huge, huge sample, right? So this is what I do in my computer. I do field work too. Digging a mammoth this summer, hopefully Clovis age, or maybe much older. We'll see. I simulate New World colonization, and I can change the colonization date. I can say, if the New World was colonized 100,000 years ago, and populations grew this way, and then we lose some of those sites to erosion, and then we sample those, and we have 25,000 sites, which is, by the way, my minimum estimate for how many sites we've dug, how close should we be to the actual colonization date? If that happened, if people colonized the New World 100,000 years ago, and we had 25,000 sites, is it possible that we would have, say, 90,000 years of invisible prehistory until everything explodes at Clovis times? Well, the answer is no. It's incredibly, incredibly unlikely. I can say, what if the New World was colonized 20,000 years ago? Human populations grew. Erosion destroys the record. We sample it. Should we have many sites that are older than 15,000 BP by now? I think the answer is yes, we should. And we can sort of, we can narrow down the range of possible colonization dates this way to find scenarios that very much fit with the archaeological record that we see today. And when I do this, specifically what I do is I look for simulation scenarios that produced, with a sample of 25,000 excavated sites, a minimum of at least 30 sites of 12,800 years in age, try to reproduce the Clovis record. And what colonization dates can we have where we can reasonably do that? And here's what I find. I don't really need to write this, actually, but if I'm going to be honest, if I'm going to just put this down to one number, I'm going to say, if anybody was in the New World before 15,000 calendar years ago, I would be very, very surprised. Any reasonable simulation I can come up with where we have reasonable rates of human population growth, where we have people living at population densities that we think they should, given their lifestyle as hunter-gatherers, they should be visible in the archaeological record within approximately 1,300 years of arriving in the New World. Here's why. Population growth, as you know, most of you probably know, is not linear, right? When populations grow, they increase slowly, then the rate of increase increases, and they increase very rapidly, and eventually they level out when they hit something called the carrying capacity, which is the maximum number of people that a continent can support. But this non-linearity means from very small numbers of people, we can very quickly produce huge populations at very slow rates of population growth. So for example, if I start with a founding population of 100 people who come into the New World from somewhere and arrive somewhere, and they grow at 1% per year, in 700 years, do you know how big this population is going to be? Any guesses at 1% per year if they grow? 700 years, they're going to be approximately 100,000 people. It's hard to hide 100,000 people in the archaeological record. Also, if you were to have a savings account and put $100 in it, and it yielded 1%, and you could live 700 years, it'd be 100 grand. Or put 1,000 in there and wait 700 years, it'd be $1,000,000. Sure would be nice to live to be 700, huh? 1% is not fast population growth for humans. Right now, we're growing at a rate of about 1.2% per year. In the 1960s, it was over 2%. Human population growth maxes out around 4% per year. In order to make a colonization date of, say, 20,000 BP viable, we have to assume some strange things. We can make it happen in my models, but we have to assume, for example, human populations grow at 0.1%. a year. Now, this number in and of itself is not very intuitive, so let me give you a sense of what that means. A population that grows at 0.1% per year doubles every 700 years. It means for a population of 1,000 people, it means one more birth than death. It's essentially population stasis. You wouldn't even notice that the population is growing. Okay, by comparison, 1% per year is one more birth than death per 100 people and doubles every 70 years. This is incredibly slow. So if human populations came in and grew very, very, very slowly, yes, it's possible that they were here 20,000 years ago and we'd have a really hard time detecting them. But then you have this conundrum. If they're growing at this rate, what this rate implies is not only are they growing really slowly, it means they're really not good at what they do. They're really having a hard time making a living, right? If your populations aren't growing, you're not getting enough food to support reproduction to increase your populations. You're implying we're dealing with essentially incompetent foragers. So if you want to imply that people were here 20,000 years ago or 40,000 years ago, you have to explain how they successfully colonized the New World while being completely incompetent at doing so, which is why I think if we use reasonable rates of population growth, 1% or greater, we can have scenarios of people being here by 15,000 years ago result in a very visible Clovis record. Pre-Clovis, in this case, would be correct. Yes, there is pre-Clovis archaeology, but it's not very much pre-Clovis. Clovis would be pretty much first, but we can allow for prehistory to stretch a few centuries to maybe 1,500 years before Clovis. We can also ask, when people come into a continent that's uninhabited, what would we expect their populations to do? Simply from the basis of population ecology, we know that populations grow fastest when they're farthest from the carrying capacity. When they're at their smallest numbers, the rate of growth is the fastest, and it makes sense, right? Because there's the most food out there relative to the number of people. We know that hunter-gatherers who eat more meat have higher fertility rates, and from what we can tell, this is something we argue about, early Paleo-Indians ate a lot of meat. We also know that hunter-gatherers who are more mobile have higher rates of fertility. Everything seems to indicate early hunter-gatherers were very mobile. So my gut tells me that when people first come into a continent, this is exactly when we expect their populations to grow quickly. Theoretically, this makes a lot more sense than this to me. If people were here 20,000 years ago, and their populations grew slowly, yes, it's theoretically possible, but we have to hide them somehow, right? We can say, okay, archaeologists simply haven't sampled sediments of the right age. But we have absolutely no trouble finding animals dating to this time period. We have Pleistocene megafauna and hundreds of them dating from pre-Clovis times. We have a really hard time finding archaeological sites dating to these times. We have hundreds of sedimentary contexts we've dated by geologists and archaeologists that predate this. And archaeology, if it's in there, is incredibly rare. So I think we have sampled this. If Topper is right, people were here 40,000 years ago, there is another possibility. I think it's important to make the distinction between colonization and dispersal. Okay, so colonization means arriving and successfully establishing a population. Dispersal would mean arriving and then dying off. So if we think about the Vikings arriving in Newfoundland, they did not colonize. They simply dispersed, died off, or left. That would be a dispersal event. So if Topper indicates people in the New World 40,000 years ago, the only way I can even think that could be possibly true is a failed colonization, a dispersal event. And finally, I suppose we can raise the possibility that there's something horribly wrong with my model. That's definitely possible. We all make mistakes, and we can also raise the possibility that we're horrible at what we do. It's been under our nose this whole time, and we haven't seen it because we failed to see it. We have all these sites that date to this time period. But to me, it might not be as sexy as saying people were here 20, 30,000 years ago, but it very much fits in my mind with what we have seen, which is this Clovis first model has persisted for a really long time because it's really good. But there are hints of people here before. And if you think about sampling this human population curve, getting this last little bit where there's very few people out there and they're very rare requires an enormous sample to find a lot of sites. And we might just be getting to that point now where this is Clovis and we're getting that 1,000 years, hints of that 1,000 years that just precedes it. So we can maintain a Clovis first, except it's not really Clovis first. I would call it Clovis pretty much first. And that's my story. Now, if you want to ask me any questions about my model, which I really can't explain in great detail here, given my visual aids, or about any of these sites specifically that suggest a deep antiquity for humans in the New World, I'd be happy to talk about them. Thank you.
Advance. My first question is, could we book you for a yearly cafe talk?
Yes.
Okay.
Not July.
Everything you said made perfect sense except for one question. We know that the sea levels were different. What about coastal populations where there are no sites left? Everything would be underwater.
Yeah, great question. I worked on that problem a little bit when I was here, actually. Right, the East Coast especially, there are large areas on the continental shelf that are now submerged. The sea level at the height of the last glaciation 20,000 years ago was roughly 300 feet lower than it is today, and humans could have been occupying, in fact, we know from certain sites in Florida that areas that are now submerged had human occupation. if we're gonna again argue for deep antiquity and we're gonna hide people under the ocean, we have to come up with some argument for why they're not moving inland, why they're essentially hugging these coastal areas, okay? And archaeologists will tell you things like, well, if they came down the West Coast, they're pre-adapted to a coastal adaptation, so they stay along the coast. But consider their options, okay? And even if that may be true, maybe they came down the West Coast, and they're coming down the coast, their populations are growing, and very quickly humans saturate their environments. And here they're living adjacent to these inland environments, full of Pleistocene megafauna that have never experienced human predation. Wonderful foraging opportunities. We have to come up with a reason why people would ignore those foraging opportunities for thousands of years. And I
am definitely not a cultural anthropologist, but isn't there a lot of some of the cultures up in the Northwest Coast area that are very specific in their choices of fauna that they eat? The people that will not eat fish, people who eat primarily fish, so that there would be some sort of a cultural bias that would take a little more time than we're, you know, you're hypothesizing to get people to change from a fishing,
sure,
you know, sea tide culture to a megafauna.
Right. So I'm no expert of Northwest Coast cultures either, but yeah, certainly people have cultural preferences in the food they eat. And that would be one possible explanation, right? We have to invoke some reason why people would ignore these wonderful foraging opportunities that are presented elsewhere. If we can come up with a cultural reason so strong that for thousands of years people, say, choose a difficult life where they're crammed up against the carrying capacity, having a hard time making a living because they have strong cultural beliefs, and ignore these other opportunities that could make their life much easier, we have to argue that's happening for thousands of years. I keep losing sound.
No, they keep moving
south. Oh, sure, they keep moving south. Here's your coast, right? And people keep moving south and keep moving south and keep moving south, but they leave populations behind. Those populations keep growing. They keep growing. As they keep moving south, these populations keep growing. And eventually they run into this problem where they're maximally exploiting their environment. Meanwhile, they're ignoring mammoths, mastodons, bison for thousands of years. Again, we have to come up with some kind of explanation like this. Other questions?
Your model assumes a single colonization always with a positive growth rate. Why aren't there many dispersal events?
You're correct. I assume a single colonization event. If we posit multiple dispersal events, we're talking about more people. We're talking about a larger founding population, which means they should be visible sooner. Okay, so if we have failed colonization events, that's one possibility for, say, a Cactus Hill site or a Topper site. I would ask you, if there's a failed colonization event that lasts a few decades or a few hundred years, what's the likelihood that we would happen to find it? I would say it's pretty low, but that is one possible explanation.
In my personal experience, compound interest never works. There's always setbacks that actually happen in the real world and don't seem to get counted in the compound interest rate. Do you have any idea whether your results would be appreciably different if, for example, every 100 years you assumed some ecological catastrophe that cut the population in half and then you let it regrow from that lower base?
Sure. Yeah, fundamentally, this is what we have to come, I think, we have to come up with some explanation for why humans would remain hidden, possibly under the water, or at an incredibly low population level for a long, 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 long time, and then explode, say, 13,000 years ago. if we were to have something like this every 100 years, the population is reduced in half, my guess is the most likely outcome, if I were to simulate that, is they would die out. But we do, if we want to argue for a deep antiquity, we have to have some explanation like this. And my gut, which who knows how good my gut is, I didn't live in the Pleistocene, is that when you enter a continent unexploited, uninhabited, your population, you're not going to struggle much. It's probably going to be a pretty good time. It might take a little while to learn how to live in that environment. You don't know the plants, you don't know the animals, but I don't see that process taking longer than a generation, and I think it would probably take a lot less than that. But again, this is one possible way we could push back antiquity of human colonization. We have to have some way to keep the population very, very low so it's barely findable archaeologically. Yeah, certainly if we had a small number of small bands spread across the continent for a very long time, we could keep them hidden. But eventually those bands are going to multiply, and we're going to end up with 70, 100,000 people, probably within 1,000 years. And even small bands, the cumulative product of thousands of small bands across the continent, this is going to show up in a rock shelter in a stratified context as a discrete layer of lithics associated with a hearth, right? So eventually you're going to get enough people, even with small bands, that they should be visible. And that was certainly the case with Folsom and Clovis. We're dealing with small bands, and we have plenty of evidence, archaeological evidence for them.
Was there any kind of reasonable way to model those loss processes?
Yeah, that's a good question. Well, first of all, I should note this model has no spatial component. So I'm looking at a giant average for North America, and obviously all of North America wasn't colonized simultaneously. And we would expect some of the best areas to be colonized first and some of the worst areas to be colonized last. For example, where I live in Wyoming, it's 7,200 feet up in the mountains where it's cold and miserable and windy all the time. Even though it's close to the ice-free corridor, I expect this is probably one of the last places for people to come. So one thing I could definitely do is add a spatial component for a little more realism. Regarding site loss, yeah, this is a problem I've worked on quite a bit, independent of this. And we can model it very, very well now. And what I've done, and other people have done since, is we look at massive collections of radiocarbon dates from geological contexts. And they all show exactly the same pattern. And we can look at the age frequency of sediments through time that have absolutely nothing to do with archaeology. Just how common are sediments from 10,000 years ago, sediments from 15,000 years ago, sediments from 20,000 years ago, sediments from 5,000 years ago. Based on this, we can estimate very well what percentage of sites at any given time should have been lost. So we turn to a non-cultural record to create the model for site loss. And I should note, it's a very large global or continental average that we use for this, but I think it works fairly well. Again, we could make the argument that we're not finding these sites because they've been lost, but we find lots of Pleistocene fauna dating to this time period. Pleistocene fauna should be even harder to find, some of them, because they don't make artifacts. All they leave behind are their bodies. Humans, we leave behind all kinds of trash, right? Even though we live at lower densities, we leave behind all kinds of stuff across the landscape that should make us, in some ways, easier to find than, say, horses and camels. We also have lots of geological context dating to this age. Did I answer your question?
I'm not an archaeologist, and everybody here probably knows the answer to this, but I'd like to know, why is it so important to be so precise about when the first person or two died?
Because you get to be like Mary, be on PBS. Yeah, that's what I was trying to say early on, is maybe it isn't that important. It's a simply historical question. It's one we as a field have put huge significance upon. I'm not sure why that is. I think part of it is the major outlets that publish our research, journals like Science and Nature, they love superlatives. It doesn't matter the field, they love superlatives. The biggest, the oldest, the rarest, the newest. And the press loves covering this stuff too. yeah, I don't know why we've attached so much value to these dates, but we have. And I don't know how much precision we'll end up having in terms of this date, say, 1,000 years from now when we're long gone.
What's your interpretation of the sites that have been... Are they just lousy dates?
Let me bring back my list. I'm not going to... I mean, I should note that out of all due respect to the people who work on these sites, I don't know a lot about them because a lot of them haven't been fully published yet. Oh, we lost some of them to the... I thought we would simulate erosion too, and we've now lost Del Marva sites and Monteverde one. No. Cactus Hill. Let's start. These are well within my time frame. Schaefer and Hebbior are mammoths. They have one or two artifacts with them. It's possible those artifacts were introduced after the fact and not really associated, but I don't know. They haven't been well published. Paisley Caves, some people have questioned whether these coprolites are really human or not. They say they have human DNA. I think they probably are. Deborah Friedkin, this is a site in Texas. Julie Morrow showed, we have artifacts beneath Clovis there, and Julie Morrow showed that it appears that the stuff beneath Clovis, it shows a lot of signals of just Clovis materials having drifted down into older sediments. For example, when we look at the artifact size in these, according to the initial publications, it looks like artifacts get smaller and smaller and smaller as we get deeper and deeper and deeper, as if they're just moving down into older sediments. Cactus Hill, this is probably one of the most important sites in my mind because we have a Clovis level stratigraphically beneath it, a discrete level that appears to be something other than Clovis. Stratigraphy tends to be fairly infallible. And if that's true, I think it indicates a pre-Clovis presence at Cactus Hill. But what they've dated here are the sands that those materials are associated. Those sands are 18,000 BP. I've worked in dunes before on a Folsom site. We found Folsom artifacts in 15,000-year-old sands. Dunes erode very regularly. And I think we have old artifacts that are sitting in sands that are much older than those artifacts. That would be my guess. But again, Cactus Hill hasn't been particularly well published. The Del Marva sites, they need to be excavated. None of them are excavated. These are artifacts coming out of cut banks, being found on eroding beaches and coming out of cut banks. We need to excavate them and see if those artifacts are truly in stratigraphic context. Monteverde 1, I don't know. I heard Tom Dillahay's going back in there. We'll see what he finds. Topper, hardly published at all, so I can't really evaluate it.
Next question's here.
Hi. So I was an anthropology student in the mid-90s as well, and I took a few archaeology classes, and the question that I always came back to was, how does this relate to where we're going as a human population today? So I was wondering if you had any thoughts about where this line of reasoning and kind of discovering when was the first human colonization of the New World, what does that say about our future, the human condition today? Do you have any thoughts through your 20 years of plus of study that have kind of, anyway, just a personal, that's where my line of reasoning would have taken me in that.
Yeah, if I had continued in the field. No, it's a good question. To be honest with you, I haven't pondered it a lot. I mean, I think about population problems a lot because I think they pervade archaeology. And I think population growth and population pressure are very powerful forces in prehistory and continue to be today. And I know there was kind of a population scare in the 70s where we were worried about human overpopulation and overusing our environment, and that continues to some extent today. The one positive thing that I can say about human population today is that human population growth is slowing. And I would say that's generally been the case over the entire history of our species, with some exceptions: industrial revolution, agricultural revolutions. We experience spurts of population growth, but then the growth slows and slows and slows as we tend to approach our carrying capacity. In Western society, we call this the demographic transition. For example, in Western Europe, many countries are not growing at all, growing very slowly, or actually shrinking in population size. And certainly, don't quote me on this, but I think that human population growth in the United States, if we don't look at immigration, is slowing as well. Family sizes are getting smaller. And I think the reason for this is, well, I'm not much of a demographer in modern times, so I don't really know, but the typical explanation is keeping up with the Joneses, that we start investing a lot more of our resources into ourselves and competing with each other rather than our offspring. And this is a universal phenomenon that we see with developing countries. Population growth slows and slows and slows and slows. So I don't worry about human overpopulation at the moment. Now, that said, we're experiencing climate change. We don't know what that's going to do. So there might be some concern. But I don't know if that answered your question, but those are a few thoughts that came to mind.
My question relates to your model, and I wondered if you had taken a look at Homo sapien populations in general, looking at current population, assuming your 1% growth rate, working backwards, and see if you come up with a very small number about 190,000 years ago.
That's an interesting question. Well, first, let me say that when I say 1% population growth rate, I mean a maximum population growth rate. I don't mean that 1% would be sustained throughout this entire time. If we look at human population growth over the long term, we know it had to be, the average population growth rate had to be an incredibly tiny number. Or else, if we were to do that kind of exercise like you're talking about, start with a founding population of modern Homo sapiens 200,000 years ago of 100 people, and have them grow at, say, 1% for that entire time, we end up with more people than could physically fit on the planet. So we know that over the long term, human population growth rate had to be very, very, very small. Had to be. But I'm talking about at this initial event, where there are no people here, how do we expect populations to grow? My gut is rapidly.
I wanted to know, at the oldest aged sites, were there actual human bones or fecal matter or whatever found there outside of Clovis points?
No. Human remains dating to the Pleistocene in the New World are incredibly rare. The oldest one that I know of, for sure, is the Anzac site in Montana, which is a Clovis cache with the remains of an infant recently dated to around 13,000 BP. Those are the oldest human remains we have from North America, to my knowledge.
Thank you so very much. This is a fantastic night.
Thanks for coming. Thanks for having me.